Hi everyone, Ari Nova here, Gaia Kingdom, and this is a conversation tonight with Hans Gunther-Kern, and I'm so delighted because Hans and I, we are starting working on a wonderful project. But before we get into this, I would like to say once again, hi, good evening, Hans, and how are you?
I'm fantastic today. I had an amazing day, very inspiring, so very happy to be on board and share with you tonight.
Fantastic. So we've promised ourselves that we're going to have this interview, which was waiting for a couple of weeks now. The amount of interesting conversations I had with Hans, they lead me to believe that we're probably going to have at least three or four of those interviews. And I really hope that we're going to be of interest for you guys, because the knowledge that Hans is going to be explaining has got some certain quality and value, and something that can really make a great step towards our evolution. And I'm not afraid to say that, because the more I observe our wonderful society with everything that is really how it's rolling, with all the wars, suffering, devastation of our planet, we really start looking for certain solutions which are really closely related with our hearts, our spirit, and with in a spirit of harmony. And between me and Hans, we do create this wonderful project, which is going to be a metropolitan project, because we're going to be doing allotments, plots in areas of London. But this is for people who would want to join a community that is going to be very integrated, closely working with the earth, with the soil, with organic fruits and veg, and really that is going to be a wonderful solution. So today we're going to speak about this a bit, as well as certain other aspects of this particular project. So for now, I'd like to ask you, Hans. I'm always curious when we talk about biodynamic farming, and this is what you do. Where is this name coming from? Why is it called biodynamic farming? Maybe you can bring up the definition for it.
Well, if I backtrack for a moment, we've got conventional or materialistic farming, chemical farming, which only deals with the chemistry and with the physicality of the earth and the minerals and all that in the earth. And we get the least nutrition out of the food grown in that way, and we're depleting the soils and obliterating and raping the planet with it, creating deserts basically, yeah, like the Romans have done. Then we got forms of agriculture like permaculture, that's based on agroecology or organic farming, which is looking at traditional farming systems and trying to emulate what they've been doing through using animal manures and green manures and compost and crop rotation and mixing plants with companion planting, etc. And you could call that's in Germany, for example, we call that biological farming. Right. So we literally are understanding now the mineral earth, how it functions, and you know, the chemistry and the water and all that, and the minerals. Then we start understanding the biology of how things function in the soil with the microlife and with the plants that inhabit with their roots the soil, and how the plants relate to the light and the air and the warmth. Mm-hmm. And then we have biodynamic farming, which in German it's called biological dynamic farming. Mm-hmm. Which really starts looking, when we look at dynamics, it has something to do with the interrelationship and the communication between the different kingdoms of nature. Right. And I believe there are four kingdoms, unless we wait a few more years and we'll see also neo-humanism creating the fifth kingdom.
Yeah,
robotic society. But right now we're looking really to see how these four kingdoms are interrelating and have been evolving, and how we as humans, with our consciousness and spiritual insights into the invisible world, how it's working through the elements, for example, of the warmth, the air, light, water, and earth elements. Yeah. How these are interrelating in the dynamic play, interplay, through the different seasons, through the weaving of the moon around the earth, right, through the constellations, and how it conveys different forces and information from the different galaxies and starry heavens, different energies, as it also, when you look at it really, that dance of the planets, and we heard of the planetary spheres and the harmonies of the spheres, which musicians were able to hear in the traditional cultures in Middle Ages still, all that through sound, through light, informs the earth. And we as humans, the plants, the animals, the soil, are intermediaries, are catalysts, are facilitators,
right,
to bring them together in a dynamic, harmonious, evolving way.
Wow. I mean, this is so fascinating. I'm like almost like stumbled. Like, to me, when I listen to this, I'm very fascinated by the cosmic events, astronomy, and the nature, obviously, as well. And when you combine those together, this is like a magnificent mixture. It's almost like when I hear what you say, there's a certain melody coming out from the cosmos, maybe we could put it this way. And the nature is listening to that, is synchronized around that. But the only species or only kingdom that is sort of out of tune, I think, is us humans, right? Wouldn't you agree?
And we are now learning how to tune in again, because the whole, in my belief, in my understanding, the whole path of evolution was actually first to get disconnected from this oneness, to become individuals in our own right. We are left on our own, as you said before. God kind of abandoned us. Where are you, God? Even Christ said it on the cross. Where are you, God? You have abandoned me. And even Christ had to go through this death process on his own, the death. And we need to actually learn to do that every moment, I believe, dying to who we are and have been to become.
Right.
Just like children.
Oh, okay.
And it's children who will inherit the heaven and the earth.
Right.
Not the adults, not the intellectual, you know, contrived thinking people who are clever, abstract, and reductionist thinking, but the ones who start integrating the whole being, because we also are having four kingdoms in us.
Yeah.
We are the cosmos. We are the human being. We are microcosm of the macrocosm.
Absolutely.
And I think when we start going out in nature, we have this wonderful opportunity to be reminded again that we breathe the air, you know, and we're communicating through the air, and we feel, and we hug the trees, and we lie down on the ground and feel the earth and the pulse of the earth. And we feel the pulse of the heart. And everything has this dynamic, biological, and also invisible interrelationship. We call it now energetic or informational relationship.
And probably what's invisible is more important than what is visible. And that's something that is so counterintuitive, because we are mainly based on our sense of sight, and we do not normally believe something we don't see that's actually being an actual phenomenon that's really happening. But, you know, every now and then we can actually see the proofs that the energy is all around us. It's kind of like when I would use like shamanic traveling and like vision quests, you know, you get to the state of mind where you can actually see beyond the veil in a certain way. You actually start seeing a reality in such a magnificent, colorful, and vibrant and energetic way, and you don't have that normally. And I think it's also greatly related with the fact that our pineal gland used to be naturally giving us a lot of DMT, which is dimethyltryptamine, which is the natural compound of our body. But now we've been depleted out of that. So the way we see reality is in just a very basic, you know, boring way, and we think it's normal. But it's not, because I just know for a fact, if you are having in your, you know, pineal gland open, you're actually able to see the energies you've been just talking about. You can see the structure of tree, you can see the tree communication. I've had this phenomenon, I've been through this, and I know it's there. It's just that people do not believe that.
very true what you're saying. Sorry for interrupting, but it's really exciting you're talking about this, because I met someone years and years ago, decades ago actually, who talked about the pineal gland, and I'm working for someone who's studied the pineal gland in relationship to fluorides in the water and paste and things. So our pineal gland has become calcified.
Yeah.
It's not breathing anymore. It's not open anymore. So as you mentioned this, it does open, and it's very interesting. It has a relationship to the moon cycle.
All right.
And when the moon gets full, the pineal gland, if it's not inhibited by the calcification through fluoride and other elements in the water and in our lack of food that we have nowadays and malnourishment, it starts breathing with that moon cycle again, and also day and night. And when we dream, it releases the hormones that will help us to actually get in touch again with everything that's around us.
Yeah.
And if we can bring that into the day, then we start living like the Mayans, for example, lived. Mm-hmm. They lived out of the dream world, as they called it, or the presence world of God and, you know, gods and so on that they had, and arranged their life accordingly, because they lived in the oneness and the presence.
Absolutely.
So you have had experiences of that. I'm very glad to hear that, because not many people had the opportunity.
Well, I'm a big fan of that, and I'm having a lot of belief in the spiritual plants, you know, the shamanic journeys, because I believe that they are the gateway to higher realms of reality. And they are, that's what they do, no questions about that. Yeah. And which again gives a different perspective for us, our limited minds, in order to set up and understand our literally place in the universe. Because what is really going on, we take so much, put so much value and tension over our mind, and everything has got to be logical, and we've been trained, literally trained to think a certain way. It's just far, far away from the truth. But again, I think it's really important to mention that also we do not need to have the substances so much used, because if we have our diet right, if we use a clean water, which is
our... Thank you. I've just had that thought, and I wanted to refer to that. Yes.
Well, you can take it from here then.
Well, it's wonderful you make that connection, because my personal belief and experience is that if we really work in the way I earlier described, of uniting the earth, literally the soil, and all organisms that live in the soil, the plants, the animals that are living in the gardens, in nature, ourselves, in that way again to the cosmos, we will be able, with that best nutrition, to vision every moment and be present again.
Yeah.
We've been separated through this abysmal way of using intellectual systems to create an approach to agriculture where we grow the vegetables and the fruit and everything with minerals that separate us from this living realm that's around us and the invisible realm. It makes us into robots, literally.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It limits our thinking, it limits our feelings, it limits our power to be energetic and willful, to do projects and see them through. It inhibits us in all realms.
And also, we are so becoming so much more dependent on technology, which I feel is generally just taking away our humanity and dignity at the same time, and which is greatly related by, you know, if you ask me. But I'm being optimistic, you know, because there's obviously the tension towards, you know, go in certain direction as we develop as a humankind, and obviously all the wars, and there is a lot of, you know, things that are pretty worrying that are happening. And we're in the beginning of January 2020. We're witnessing incredible fires in Australia, which is just really absolutely terrible. But at the same time, I can see the fractional society really looking at seeing what it is and how much of that is weather manipulation, how much of that is really being affected by the systems of some of cabal or people who, maybe not even people, but you know, there's forces which are entangling all this reality here. But, you know, at the same time, to me, it becomes a sort of like a pressure to get out of my comfort zone and to start really looking deeper into reality, to see what's really going on behind the veil. And for me, I'm using this as a sort of tool to develop my consciousness, and I can start seeing the escape, but really like solutions. And to me, it's about really activating our full potential, like the human potential, and mainly to do with the, you know, with our senses. Like, I don't know if you've seen this, I'm not watching TV, but I had a chance to see a few episodes of the series C. It's called C. It's a new series. I'm not saying it's a very good series, it's pretty okay, but this is about the humanity post-apocalyptic. Like, people have been taken away with their main with their vision. They've literally been taking their vision from the gods because they punished them for how ignorant they were and how they led, you know, everything to absolute chaos. To me, it's the same. Like, we might have been taken away from our first eye, because it's actually literally, it should have been the first eye if it's activated properly, and we've been taken away that, you know. So it's a metaphor. Yeah. It's probably a metaphor.
I see. With my inner eye.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's probably where the I see from Avatar comes from. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, this is wonderful, but our conversation is rolling towards in different different aspects of what we wanted to discuss. I wanted to talk to you mainly about the agricultural aspects and the farming. Now, we are going to be holding a workshops on the 8th of February, in which you will be getting people more familiar with this all these concepts, and you're also going to be doing the manual workshop. I believe that it's going to be things that you're going to show to people, what is the happy plant and how to make sure that you know how to recognize the true value in it. I'm very curious, can you release any of that information? How do you look into the plant? Because from what I know, it's like an intelligent entity. So you can even communicate with that, right? Do you happen to do that?
It's a wonderful question. It opens up a whole can of worms in a way, a whole diverse aspect of who we are. Because as you mentioned earlier, we usually are used to look at things. And our sight, sense of sight, is the most crude kind of impression that we get from life. And it's very connected with making preconcepts and concepts and recognizing things. Whereas as we go to other senses, for example, touch, it's very different. Yeah. And funnily enough, nowadays, we're not used to touching natural things anymore. We don't even touch our food anymore. We eat with forks and knives and spoons. And we deprive children of having that experience when they're children, to touch the mud, to touch the grass, to touch the tree. They're getting dirty. They need to have that experience. We need to have that experience. We don't hug each other anymore. We don't go out in nature, touch anything anymore. It's our sense of identity which gets lost. And once we lose our identity, we encapsulate ourselves. And we're not going out anymore and meeting people as individualities that can communicate. And communication breaks down. Yes. The same thing has happened on an intercellular level because of the lack of nutrition and the poisoning with glyphosate and other substances that we're ingesting every day. But coming back to the senses, so the sense of sight, the sense of touch. Now, in the workshop, I'm going to take people through the different senses and looking at different vegetables and fruit from different growing conditions. And you can actually, when you start touching things, feel the difference in quality.
Yeah.
But you have to learn. You have to obviously have some experience of comparison to do that. So we're starting a process of encouraging people to use these tools that I'm going to teach them, to apply them in their daily life. Every day, hopefully in the future, to actually elaborate the sense, because we've lost the sense of touch. I deal with it every day in the gardens, and when I do my firewood and everything, I touch everything. When I eat, I try to eat a lot by hand. Now, the other sense that's a bit more subtle is the taste.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, the taste, 5 different flavors, very important to actually flavor the food, savor the food that we ingest, and dissolve all the flavors that are embedded and hidden in the structure of the proteins and the carbohydrates. So we're going to practice that on vegetables and fruit and seeds, by the way. Seeds are amazing. They're like dynamite.
Yeah.
So get for a mind-blowing experience, actually, just tasting things. Now, you would...
Gets me to the next question about the seeds, actually. But please carry on, because...
No, just finish the 4, the 5 senses.
Right.
So the hearing, in a finer sense.
Yeah.
And... if you move things, even your food, when you have fresh vegetables, you can move them. You can hear the structure. You can hear the sound of the plant and get a relationship through sound.
Wow.
And, of course, then there's the smell. And our olfactory sense, would you believe it? I've done a lot of studying on aromatherapy. They've now found that every cell in our body actually smells and responds.
Really?
From the smell that we inhale through the olfactory into the limbic system, into the subconscious, and releases amazing endorphins. Because if we smell something plant related that's deliciously smelling, aromatically smelling, scented, it uplifts the spirit. It puts us from the right brain frontal lobe into the left where we have the good feelings.
Right.
So people will take the vegetables, we'll break them, we taste them, we smell them. And we'll follow that up also with exercises out in nature, because understand where we are, we have even an ornamental garden. And even though it's winter, there are plants flowering now. And if you start scratching away on barks, they all have smells and, you know, different textures and things.
Yeah.
So we really want to get in touch with those things. And then we have 5 subjects which we're going to cover, which is basically recognize your own multidimensional being and nourish it fully. That's one subject. The other one is learn to discern vitality and nourishing, you know, aspects in the food. And then we're going to discover how to connect to our inner nature and outer nature around us. We explore how you give back to Mother Earth, Gaia, and also how to grow our own health, which will lead into the further on workshops that we'll be giving in the future, hopefully in the green city gardens or the Gaian gardens in our Gaian community.
Absolutely. Well, that's why we're teaming up, you know, with this knowledge and that spirit that is being created among the conscious community we're building. You know, this is just going to fly. It's going to be wonderful. You know, and most of what you just said is just so fascinating. I mean, I didn't know half of that about the senses, and you know, I honestly cannot wait for the workshop. It's such a wonderful adventure, and I'm so happy that we're organizing that. So one thing I wanted to ask you, when you talked about the seeds, I'm still largely influenced by the books of Vladimir Negre and Anastasia. If you, my listeners, watchers, did not read those books, please get on this, because they're bringing a lot of fascinating knowledge and a wonderful connection with some sort of a higher entity. And you know, it's pure magic. But apart from magic, there's so many things that can be proven, and it has been actually literally tested and proven that they are true. One of them being that when you take a seed of a plant, you can put it in your mouth, and then by keeping it for a few minutes, you can actually program the plant in order for it to be more calibrated and more compatible with yourself, with your probable health issues and things like that. So do you find this true? You know, did you have the chance to experience
it? It's 100% true, because if you think of microbiology, I give you a far out example. People were able in the 1940s and 1950s, there were two doctors in Germany, inject microbiological organisms that were bred in the laboratory and multiplied from an organic garden at their clinic and inject them intravenously into people with chronic illnesses who feed on the same food grown from the same soil, and they heal in a very short amount of time from very, very severe chronic illness.
Right.
Now you think the mouth has a microbiome, has a microbiological expression, different in each human being, just like the gut biome is different, just our biochemistry is different.
Yeah.
If you expose that seed to that epigenetic field of microbiome in the mouth, it will have a memory for its own activation of the DNA. The R&D expression of that plant will be specific to your individuality. And your lack and your excess will be, through the plant as a mediator, be balanced, just like the plants balance out what's in the cosmos and what's in the soil. And if there's something lacking in the soil, the plants will pull it in. So the plants are highly intelligent, and it starts with the seed, but it starts with that dynamic interplay and communication between your microbiome and that expression of the seed that then modulates it, so to speak, to your organism.
Yeah. So in that case, very shortly, the answer is yes. It is as in the books of Anastasia, but they did not mention, at least not to what I read. I'm on the fifth book of the Anastasia, and they didn't mention what you mentioned last time I spoken to you about the possibility of the plant to extract certain specific nutrients, which it would individually for a person, but would you be able to train the plant not to extract certain nutrients which might not be so beneficial, i.e. poisonous, as we do have them all around us, especially in the metropolitan like project like we're going to be creating. This is going to be obviously so is there
and I just found out where you're living, thanks to the Germans, you have 1.7 percent more, 1.75 times more lead in the soil than in other areas which are, you know, polluted from car traffic or what have you, because of the bombing and the lead from the piping in the houses that went in the soil. So lead, we know, is a very strong toxin.
How
can we avoid that lead, talk about the lead, gets into the brain where it could cause paralyzation, all sorts of things, Alzheimer's and what have you. The plants are sensitive beings, just like us. If I ask you to look around in a room and ask you look just for white color, you will focus on the white and you will not pick up the other things in your consciousness, other colors. The plant, if we have tools, and in biodynamic agriculture, we have tools to sensitize the plants and help them to focus on the beneficial substances and forces and information to pick up, and we're building a strong humus structure in the soil, then the plant will not need to take up the poisons. It will take up only the beneficial substances. Let me give an example in reverse. If you poisoned yourself with mercury, lead, or any other heavy metals, what do you use to actually get rid of those metals? You use plants. You use the lowest forms of plants, which are algae, like chlorella, spirulina. Then you can use essential oils like cilantro. It will detox, it will chelate those substances and detox and eliminate them through your gut. Same is true in the soil. If you, for example, have a high fiber diet, you're detoxing all the time, because the high fiber diet will encourage bacteria that will help with the detoxing. They found that in chemotherapy, people have acclimensa bacteria in the gut, which creates a beautiful mucus lining around the gut to prevent chemicals going into your body. People with that kind of gut bacteria recover faster from chemotherapy, and chemotherapy is actually effective because these bacteria break down the chemotherapy chemicals to then boost the immune system for the immune system to heal the cancer and eliminate the chemotherapy through the gut. The same happens in the soil. There are antibiotics in the soil. There are intelligent beings. The microbiome of the soil and of the gut and the human brain everywhere, they're so intelligent. We need to just give them the right food and the right information, and they will help us to be healthy and balanced.
Yeah, there you go. So once again, we're learning and reminding ourselves that our body is designed by incredibly intelligent force, and it's got all it needs to heal itself. We just need to stop disturbing it from doing so. We just need to stop intoxicating it, not only with food and water, but with our thoughts and the way we feed our brains, our consciousness. And so can we expect with your workshop that you're going to be also touching on some certain spiritual parts, and how do you integrate this knowledge, the practical knowledge, with some sort of additional knowledge from lectures, and possibly some certain meditation maybe techniques, or some grounding techniques to allow people to exchange more energy with Gaia?
We will work through exercises where we use observation, we use imagination, we use also inspiration, and we use intuition. Now, all those are deeply spiritual. What is spirit? What is spiritual? Where does matter, there's spirit. So once we use these spiritual faculties that we have as a human being to its fullest extent, because even observation is a spiritual activity, if we're focused on something and then thinking about it and then feeling and integrating that, that's a spiritual activity. If we use imagination, we're actually starting becoming creators. Mm-hmm. And we will see in the workshop how we will actually be able to give back to the plants and to nature through imagination. When we're inspired, we will then lift that amazing will force and amazing power that we have within and share it with nature. We give life forces and energy to the nature again. And if we come into the intuitive state, we become part of the presence of every being in nature. So if we start practicing, again, using these tools, which I will be introducing there, and people, you know, then practicing with them, not just at the workshop, but hopefully integrating it more into their life, they will realize that it will actually live fuller and more balanced in their whole being. Because we have all these different bodies in our being that are disconnected. I mean, it starts here, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's where it starts.
Up there in the cave, people in the cave, and they stay there, and they stay in their comfort zone, in their fear zone, and the fight, flight, and then that's it, you know? Yeah. We're going to get them out there into getting in touch.
Yeah. Well, we're here to show them the other way. We're here to show them there's a different alternative.
And it's all about practice.
Absolutely, yeah. So, and I think it's the right time because, as I mentioned before, there's a lot of things happening. Like, we really, really live in a very dynamic, challenging times. But I think, I wanted actually to take this conversation on a slightly different pole now. And for all the people who would say that, we're so ungrounded, we're so talking about only spirituality. But I'd like to talk about maybe why is a good time for us to carry out this type of projects. Because as far as I know, and you told me this before, that the mayor of London has announced that there is a certain legislation in place that being introduced, that this city, particularly London, needs to become much greener. So can you tell us about that? Is this true?
Well, the time is more than ripe or matured. In the sense that even on the official political levels, they're realizing they're running out of tools, they're running out of money, they're running out of time, they're running out of ideas, and they need to reach down to the ground level, to the grassroots level, to people in touch with nature, the people in touch with natural health solutions, to people who are in touch with community building, the people who are in touch with who they really are and can help other people to get them out of their misery. Because it's like, how can we help people to get into action? They notice that if they send, and you know, there's plenty of studies, if doctors are sending people to do meditation, yoga, gardening, they call it social prescribing now.
Right.
Okay, social prescribing. They realize that there was a community in Massachusetts that was all Italians that settled there, and they had no heart disease at 55 years of age when the rest of America had heart disease. So much that people, you know, so many percent died from heart disease at 55. Mm-hmm. There was no death in that community. What did they have in the first place? Community.
Mm.
There was community, friendship, and there was always that backdrop of, you know, that circle of people you could fall back on.
Mm.
And I think they realized they have segmented society into different faculties of, you know, doctors, of social workers, of mental health practitioners, of gardeners, farmers, you know, name it, you have it.
Yes.
All specialists, none talking to each other, no interdisciplinary approach. And I think they've realized now, finally, even in the city, that's become such a jungle that's so chaotic, that they need to actually bring these different factions together to actually communicate and to create programs. And, you know, they're now looking for organizations that will actually implement that. So there's a strategy in place, which is the Green Belt and food security policy that integrates all those different factors that I've just mentioned.
Yeah.
So the time's ripe. There's functional medicine practitioners out there that are already really priming and teaching in Bristol University already these kind of practices. So we will have the backing even from the NHS.
Yeah. Well, that's a very important thing to mention, because as you just said, and there's been doctors prescribing contact with nature as a medicine. Well, hopefully that humanity is growing into this sort of adulthood and full understanding of how nature is really taking care of us, because otherwise we're going to be in big trouble. Hans, this was very, really one of the most profound conversations I had. You know, I'm so glad we had that. We're hitting the 40 minutes mark very soon, so I just want to make sure that we don't make this interview too long. Before we finish and wrap up, would you like to maybe elaborate on anything, any of the subjects we have touched on today? And before we also invite people for the workshops, anything to add?
I think to finish on a positive note, like you mentioned during the interview also, with all the disasters we're seeing, with all the challenges we're facing in our own personal life, psychologically, physically, health-wise, or, you know, with finances or what have you, and stress and all that, there is a positive outlook. There is the potential to heal from all that, to get into a new state. And all you need to do is look for the right tools. And we're here to serve you. And it's my pleasure, really, to open up my mind to see where you are and to start from where you are and take you to another level. Because all we can do is a step at a time. You know, we beat ourselves up of failing and all that, but it's about taking a step at a time, picking ourselves up when we're falling with whatever practice that is, and not punishing ourselves, getting out of that self-judgmental state, being more loving. And I think with all that we want to introduce with Gaia Kingdom is this, the spirit of nurturing and caring, and also focus. You know, there's also the male element there and the will to actually manifest things together in community, which is that holding space of the nurturing mother that we need, of manifesting the gardens, the centers, the places where people can anchor again in dignity and find their roots. Because I think we're uprooted and this is the time. And I've seen 30, 40 years in England of amazing projects. Even in London, there's so many already. But we're going to add to that, and we're going to Well, I would say marry together heaven and earth, really, in the garden and in our hearts.
Yeah.
So we actually can flourish again and become who we really truly want to become as each one of us.
Yeah. Well, let us be the change we want to see in the world, because it's all start with us here. So we're making this brave step. It's for us, it's a journey towards public service. In the end of the day, it's an incredible privilege and way to express myself in the most divine way. That's the way I feel that. Thank you very much, Hans, for this conversation. For everyone who would love to join for our workshops with Hans on the 8th of February, please watch the link below. Also, I would like to say that there's still place for volunteers who would like to come and join us with the project Green City. At the moment, we're building a team of volunteers who want to join us and start to spread the word around the community that we're building on the internet, on Facebook group Gaia Kingdom, which I very warmly invite you to. Once again, Hans, thanks very much for this conversation and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you for the invitation and being able to share.
Wonderful.
Lots of love to you all. Bye-bye.
Lots of love. Thank you.